Welcome to Creative Living with Jamie. I'm your host, Jamie Riddler of Jamie Riddler Studios. On this program, I'll be talking to a wide range of creative independent spirits in order to bring you inspiration, stories, and strategies for bringing creativity to life. I hope you'll join me every week. Who knows, one day I might just be talking to you.
So hey everybody, welcome to Creative Living with Jamie. We have a bit of a different episode today. So where it is the same is whenever I'm starting the intro to the show, I sit here in the studio and I kind of look around my space and I pay attention to it and I kind of get grounded in what's happening right now, what the weather is, and it's so funny because in this show, the first go of recording, it was sort of like, hi, hello, construction outside. So that was already a little bit different. But what we're doing today is we're having the season finale, the first ever season finale of the podcast. And I've invited Shannon to come from her editor's chair into the show. Hey, Shannon.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Jamie.
And not only that, on top of that, we're trying something new. Again, special for the season finale is that we are creating the audio podcast like we always do, but we're also going to share a video cast of this on Creative Living TV. So if you're a regular podcaster and you want to see what it's like when we're creating the show, come on over to Creative Living TV. .ca, I think it is. Mm-hmm. And you can see the video there. And if you're regularly joining me for behind the scenes or on YouTube, this is a great way for you to know what the podcast is like if you want to join me over at creativelivingwithjamie.ca and subscribed in iTunes. Mm-hmm. So Shannon and I, we're going to do a little reminiscing as good for a season finale. Shannon, I'm thinking about what's that fishing show you like so much?
The Deadliest Catch.
Deadliest Catch. And then, right, they have, is it at the end of the season or the beginning of the season, they sort of all get around the table and talk about the show?
Yeah, they've had ones called The Bait, where they talk about the show while you're watching the show, and then they also have one where they do a roundup sort of afterwards and go around the table and talk about great moments, scary moments, you know?
So that's what we're going to be doing, talking about great moments and scary moments.
I'm trying to think of some scary moments. I don't want to.
I guess any time it's been a scary moment is usually when there's some technical difficulty.
Yeah.
You know, or something where we feel like we have a pretty particular schedule of how we try to get out the show. And then if something happens, we're like, maybe we have to give the show a pass this week. Maybe we need to give ourselves some space. That's what I can think of as the scariest moments.
Yeah. For me, it's anything technical, forgetting to save as, you know, those kinds of like where'd it go? Where'd that whole edited thing go? Or I don't know if you've had this, you know, if you have a problem with an interview, you know, I've had that with my other podcasts that I used to have. And there's nothing worse than having to ask a guest to do it all again.
Oh my gosh. I had one. I'm so glad to have found Zoom as a way to record the podcast because Skype and recording the interviews is not the friendliest with PCs. It seems to work a lot better. Maybe that'll change actually because Windows has taken it over. Microsoft now owns Skype, right?
So maybe, really?
I think so. Don't quote me on that. But if that's the case, maybe they'll eventually allow us to record that better. But I did a whole interview on the imposter complex with my dear friend Tanya Geisler and Lauren Bacon, the two of them had created a program together, and we had like this deep and rich and amazing conversation. And then I knew I wasn't going to use it for a couple of weeks, so I just sort of kept it in the can, as they say. Mm-hmm. And I went to listen to it, and I listened to me enthusiastically saying hi, and then silence. Just every time they were sharing their wisdom, it was,
oh, that's heartbreaking.
And oh, it was so, and then we ended up having so much scheduling difficulty that we ended up just doing the recording with Tanya, and I didn't get to interview Lauren again. Aww. And so
maybe in the future you can talk to your sister.
Maybe I'm gonna, Lauren, I'm coming for you.
One that got away.
There's that fish metaphor again.
Yeah.
So yeah, so then, okay, so what was it they talked about, what's great and what's scary? So we hit what's scary.
Yeah.
What's been great? Oh, let me just say another scary moment though too, because it happens some. I think out of all the interviews that I've done, and there's a lot now, I mean, we've hit over 250 shows.
Yeah, it's big.
And not all those shows have been interview shows. Sometimes there's Tea for Two, Me and You shows, and you know, or like little smaller segments, but that a lot of them have, most of them have been.
Yeah.
And out of all of them, the one that was for me the scariest was Julia Cameron. And you know, it's just that her book, The Artist's Way, was absolutely the most referred to book on this show. She is the icon of creative living, really started this conversation with people, and she's no nonsense, that lady.
She knows her stuff.
And she, when she came on the show, she was very clear about her work, about what it was about what she wanted to share. And so it ended up being a really great conversation. And I remember too, though, it was, I don't know if it was because of where she was at the time, but it was really dark. I think I interviewed her at like 7 o'clock at night or something, and it was in the middle of winter and it was dark. It was just like me and the phone and Julia Cameron. So it's like this kind of intensity to it too. But I was delighted to have that conversation, but it was the one I was most nervous about at the time.
Wow, but you did it.
But I did it. It was awesome. And I mean, one of the things I re-remember every time, and I remind my guests of too, if they're nervous, because a lot of times people are nervous to be on the show. And they usually tell me that before we start recording. And I think in part that's because I like to interview people like Julia Cameron, has been interviewed millions of times, and people for whom this is the first interview they've ever given. Mm-hmm. What I remind them and what I remind myself of is it's just a conversation.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like if you and I were sitting over coffee at a coffee shop and we were talking about art and creativity and what inspires us. I mean, that conversation could go on forever.
It does. We have them, lots of them.
That's why we have our own show too with Susie, our other sister, start, so that we can have those conversations and share them. It's conversations, I think, sharing our stories is important.
It's wonderful. And it's amazing to think of how many people you've spoken to over the years about their creativity. And it's, you know, for me, it's like, it's wild, because it's like, I'm always interested. It's like, what's this person gonna say? What's their take on that? Ah, I really agree with that. Or I've never thought of that before. Like, it's just, it's amazing how refreshing it can be each and every time.
Absolutely. And it can really open up your mind to fresh perspectives. I'm pretty sure it was Jill Bodonsky that did this one, because I think of it all the time as one of the most shocking moments on the show. And it was a while ago. And I remember you being shocked too. You know, sometimes everybody, when editing the show, she'll like send me an email and go, oh my gosh, I can't believe blah, blah, blah. Like, we'll begin conversation about the show before the show even airs. And she said that, you know, when you get that pile, I always have that pile of stuff.
Yeah.
Her pile of papers and stuff gets to be too big, she just puts it in a box and puts it away.
I almost can't hear you say that. but it's wild. I'm like, I really never would have thought of doing that. Never. It also takes me months, if ever, to unpack. I am, whenever I move, I always have a million boxes, and packing when you're not going anywhere, it's like, what? But you can do it. Like, I'm trying to think of how freeing that would be, because you know that it's somewhere safe. You didn't get rid of it. It's just a way. And you can keep going. Why not do it? Why not?
The wonderful thing is that if something does come up, you're like, you know what? It'll probably be in that box. Mm-hmm. And then you know where to look. And if you didn't need to do that, you didn't waste all sorts of time. I mean, Justin does that with his receipts for the year. He just tosses it in the box. I'm like, what? You had to file it. And he's like, I may never have to do anything with those, in which case I've saved time. And I have them all in one place per year, so that's fine. I'm like, smart.
Yeah. I get like, it's so weird. I get really micromanaging on stuff and it's been an eye opener to realize that sometimes that's not useful. You know, yeah. Sometimes it's a waste of time and if you only have so much time, so might as well spend it. There's that great quote, the Mary Oliver quote. I can never remember it.
The soft body, soft animal of your body, love what it loves. That one.
No,
what are you going to do with your one wild and precious life? Yes. Yeah,
and I don't know if sorting receipts is on there. Like, I like that kind of stuff, but, you know, maybe, I don't know, maybe.
Yeah, it wouldn't be on
my having money. Iced tea and having the wind fall through my hair might be a little bit better.
Yeah, I'm going to go with you on that one. And what I love, I just want to say, to the flip side of what Jill said, she did say that when she then gets in that mood where she feels like sorting and then she'll open it up.
That's awesome.
And I'm like, oh, totally get that. I love that you brought up that quote because I think that quote of what are you going to do with your one wild and precious life is a touchstone,
yes,
you know, for the creative community. And it's one really worth thinking of. And, you know, while we're off season, you know, while we're in that break before we come back in September, because that's our plan, everybody will be back in September. Spend some time. Like, I love to encourage everybody, including us, to, you know, while we're taking a break, to spend some time on whatever it is that we really want to do with our one wild and precious life. I know, I mean, when I do doing the show is one of those things for me. Mm-hmm. Doing all the work I do at the studio is one of those things for me. I want to be spending this life immersed in creativity, helping people, you know, bring their creativity to life. It's not just a slogan. It's, you know, I really want to help people awaken their creative capacity. And I want that for the world because mm-hmm. I just think we are going to be so much more capable of dealing with the hard and expanding on the great when we can show up with our creative capacity, like raring to go. Mm-hmm. That's actually what I want to be doing. And so, yeah. And experiencing stuff. I think that we creatives need to fill our creative well. And we need to have, you know, get it. And it can be big or small. It can be traveling to a new country or it can be trying, walking into a new store. It can be trying a new food. Like, remember when mom would always do that?
Yeah. Come home with like fruit you've never heard of, be like, try this. Really?
Okay. Star fruit. For some reason, I really remember the star fruit and how we would cut it in different ways and cut it. So
Lychee fruit. Those ones, and you never, like, I love the adventurous spirit of that, you know, like, and it's not, that one's not that hard, you know, it's just at the store, just something you don't know, pick it up, maybe research how you're supposed to eat it, you know.
I love the spirit. Like, remember stinky fruit? Like, you've got to be a little prepared for stinky fruit, which is, I think, really called durian? I think it's durian.
I think so, yeah.
All sorts of adventures to be had. And I think for me, that's a part of this year with the podcast. We've been trying different things. You know, I think we sort of been here and not here, did the Tea for Two episodes. I think there'll always be for some Tea for Two episodes. Recently, we shared some of the Creative Living bookshelf. Yeah. We've started inviting people to share a short, sweet, and useful Creative Living tip. And we'll be able to share that on the podcast, which is very exciting. I was like, what did we find new music for last time?
We did for the bookshelf. And the Shine the Light.
Oh, yeah, the Shine the Light, which is, you know, just really trying to ask people that if you love the show, share it. I don't know if everybody's seen that hashtag, sharing is caring.
That's awesome. I love sharing. It's one of my faves.
And it really, you know, the example I like to use is that the show, the work at the studio, the BTS is like Tinkerbell. And when you are like, you know, sending encouragement and sharing it out in the world, you just help the energy get better and better and better.
It's so awesome.
And it's such a nice thing. You know, if this, one of the reasons I love talking to so many people on the show is that somewhere along the line, I continue to hope that each time I'll find a story that's the right story for the people who are in the audience. You know, and so one week maybe there's a story that's particularly there for you. And I feel like if we can share the podcast and with other people, and if you give us a positive rating on iTunes, that also helps us reach more people, that maybe just maybe somebody is sitting at home and they are, as so many people have written to me and told me has happened with them, they're feeling down or sad or discouraged. They're having a hard time believing in their creativity, but they know, like they feel it. They know it inside, and it's the getting it from the inside to the outside and trusting themselves. And then I just hope that when we share it, one more person who's doing their laundry feeling discouraged, right? One more person who's riding the subway to their crappy, oppressive job. Like, you know what? I mean, I've been each of those people, right? Like, you know, that one more person will feel hopeful and touched and inspired to get out and start creating.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. It's nice to hear where, I love hearing where people listen to the show, because for me, of course, I listen to the show in the same spot, and to me, it's all like blue lines, you know, and like audio, and I, you know, like, it's like, and it's, I see it visually, you know, like very differently in a editing program, and so that's how I know all of the people by their voices, and then and I finish it up, I look at the post and see the picture, and I'm like, oh, that's who that is. I should give it the reverse order, you know? So I get a sense of who the person is, not that, like, whether they're, like, big, like, poppy lines or, like gentle. I'm trying to remember, there was someone you interviewed, and she had such a gentle, gentle voice. Hiro Boga?
Yes.
And the rhythm of her speech was, like, it was, like, I can't edit her. Like, I can, it has to be the way that it is, like the rhythm is part of it, you know, because I always want to try and make it shorter, you know, not in a bad way, just like, you know, people are busy, right? Not everything needs a dramatic pause. And I'm like, oh my god, all the like interviewees are going to be like, what? Just, you know.
I love that perspective of, you know, seeing everybody or getting to know them first by the blue audio sound waves of their voice. And it is so weird that over all this time you do get to recognize things like, I can look at the program, and we use Audacity. I can look at that and go, oh, that's where I laugh.
Yeah, I can recognize your laugh.
And it's always like three big spikes. That's my laugh. I should get a t-shirt. You laugh
on it. Oh my god, this is me laughing. Oh my god, that's awesome.
So funny. And there's, you know, there's often lots to laugh at, usually myself. Usually by being so entertained at something that is going on. But so I'm just going to go back to that sort of experimental nature that we've been having, and I think we're going to continue to do that. And I hope that people will really enjoy, you know, one of the things we're kind of thinking about for the podcast is thinking about it in segments. You know, so that we'll do a little book segment, we'll do the interview as a segment, the little whatever I have to share as a segment, the shine the light segment, the tip segment, and who knows? Who knows what else?
Could be more.
Could be more.
Crazy. I'm sure that you're like segments, because each segment gets its own sound.
Oh my gosh, we've had so much fun. Like, it is a little overwhelming to try to choose sound and music, and then to be like, do these work together? Does it matter? Should it be long? Should it be brief? I still love my studio news, still has the sound that I love. I love that so much. And it's a lot of fun to let the show grow and to let it sort of find a new rhythm. Because, man, podcasting, when we started, this was a tiny little thing. This was
the new frontier.
Absolutely. And I mean, even the real beginning of me, for me, was creating Your Creative Spark, which was a collection of 12 interviews, 10 interviews. And, 12. And the reason I think, Shannon, the reason I did that was because you looked out into the world of all these wonderful people, you know, Christine Mason Miller, Jen Lemon, and, you know, we hadn't heard their voices. Mm-hmm. Like literally just that, what is it, 7 years ago, we hadn't heard their voices. And I was like, I want to. And now, man, everybody's making videos. They have their own pod. I mean, this is a different world we're in. Mm-hmm. And it's expanded so much. And so I want to make sure we keep that grassroots loving feeling in the podcast, that sense of good conversation in a coffee shop about things that matter. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, you know, I don't know, let it be what it wants to become. Mm-hmm. And that takes a little experimentation. It takes a little exploring. I like myself, like I like short bites of lots of cool things. And so that's a little bit of where I'm thinking. That's why we're doing these segments. Mm-hmm. I also think that mostly people for podcasts often still, like you said, we're busy. We're on one of the things people, the reason they listen to a podcast as opposed to watch things that some of you are probably watching right now, is that it's takes them on a journey. Like they can go somewhere and listen at the same time.
It's more intimate too. Like it's, you know, you and your headphones, you know, going down the street or on break or, you know, data entry. I know that's when I did data entry. I listened to so many podcasts. I was like, I like data entry, but, you know, like, or whatever it may be. Like there is a closeness, I think, when you're listening and, you know, and can feel like you're there.
And somebody's right in your ear.
Yeah, you know? That's close.
It makes me think about, and I probably shared this story on one of the, like, sort of, when we did a year celebrations. One of my first experiences in broadcasting was many, many years ago, when my boyfriend at the time was a radio DJ at CKLN here in Toronto. And he let me do a storytelling segment. And it was recorded at like 1:30 in the morning or something. Like he came and picked me up at the car at 1 and we drove down. And so it was like right in the middle of the night and the studio's pitch black. And you're in this booth and you've got the headphones on. And you're just talking into this nothingness. And for me, the revelation of that was, because people ask me this question, I didn't feel like I was talking to nobody. Mm-hmm. I felt like I was talking to everybody. Mm-hmm. I could just, it was like being transported, mm-hmm. you know, onto everybody's radio station late at night as they were trying to fall asleep or as they were just getting home or listening in the car and I loved that. I felt like it was this magical connection that you could have through the airwaves. And maybe that's where the idea of podcasting really started for me, way before podcasting was even invented.
Yeah.
Because I loved that so much.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. And I think it makes a difference to feel like that, like for the creators out there, that you are talking to everyone.
Yes.
You know, to feel that connection. You know, it's a beautiful thing, you know, and I think it's one of the amazing things about like online communities and being able to connect with people over the world, you know, different time zones even, you know, like it's really nice that we can find more people, more like-minded, awesome peeps.
And that's why I think, you know, if somebody was thinking of starting a podcast or a video series or anything like that, anything that has in the studio, we would say a performative element to it. Mm-hmm. So we sort of break things down into practice, projects, and performance. So those performance level things. The piece of advice I would have would be to look for the real, you know, to not suddenly feel like now it's time for me to put on a show and now I need to talk. And we often do this when we're taking on a role we're not used to. We start to model what we've seen or what we think it's supposed to be like. When I started in business, I definitely did that. I started to do those business things,
right,
quotes, that you were supposed to do. And it didn't feel like me and it didn't feel good and it wasn't successful. You know, whereas if you show up as you, there can be an opportunity for much greater connection. And I think one of the reasons people are nervous about that too is it is way scarier to say, this is what I honestly think. This is who I honestly am. And if you don't like this, then you don't like me, or you don't like my thought, or you don't like, you know, and so it feels vulnerable.
Yes.
You know, but I also feel that the truer we are, the more honest we are, the truer we are to ourselves, the more chance we have of hitting that universal chord.
Yes.
It goes bing, whether we're here or in Australia or Scotland, whether it's 2 a.m. or 2 p.m, summer, winter, we're student-y people, or we're working people, we're full-time artists, or we're full-time, you know, workers in a day job field. It doesn't matter. We are all in this together. And that's, I really believe that if your heart is called to the creative work, if your heart is called to the arts, then we are in this thing together.
Mm-hmm. I like that. I like that slogan.
I like that too. I sort of found, like, for over the past few years, there's certain things that have become, you know, just studio principles, like honor the work.
Yes.
Honor the work is just, that is, when you walk through the door, we learned this from Marjorie, our dancer, who's also been a guest on the show. You walk in that door, you honor the work. It doesn't mean you're not going to have fun. You are going to have theaters like that too. You are going to laugh. You are going to fall in love. You are going to go for beers. You are going to, you know, be a family. Mm-hmm. And you are going to honor the work.
Yes.
That's just, you know, and so, but we're in this together has been showing up this year as a real, I think, a real theme. And maybe that's because of introducing clubs.
Journal Club.
Journal Club. Hey, Journal Clubbers. Hey, bear crowd. We've got the summer bears.
Yeah.
And I think maybe that's a part of it, is just feeling like, if we all show up for this time together and we all honor the work, we feel like we can really feel how we're in it together.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Amazing.
The studio way.
The studio way.
I love having the studio way.
Yeah, me too. And I love having this podcast has been such a, it's been a central part of the studio. And I think that there are a lot of people who start their relationship with the studio and with me, you know, here, you know, who started by listening. And I love when I get letters from people, or people show up for, let's say, Circe Circle, my group coaching program, and they'll tell me the stories about, hey, I started out listening to the show, or people I have interviewed, you know, that say, I have listened to this show so many times and listened to when that intro says, and one day maybe I'll be talking to you. And they're like, now you are.
That's so wonderful. Like, it's so, and for me, like, 'cause I hear the intro every week and I'm like, and I always smile at that part, you know, 'cause I'm like, people are out there.
I love that. And it's one of the reasons why people ask me a lot how I choose my guests. And it's, you know, and I say people, I choose people when they sparkle at me. And I sincerely mean that. And because I'm really in this community, you know, and then I could have talked to somebody for 2 years and all of a sudden one day something happens. I'm like, you should be on my show, you know? And it's just this intuition, now is the right time, and I just trust that. And so it really is true that anybody I'm talking to, who knows, one day I could, like, literally we could meet each other at a conference and we could be chatting and I could say, you should be on my show.
That's awesome to follow your intuition that way.
That's been the absolutely 100% the primary guide for the people, you know, that I choose to invite onto the podcast. Mm-hmm. And that just reminds me, there's a lot to celebrate with the podcast this year. We got featured in a few wonderful places this year. One, I didn't even know this till a friend told me, is that we were featured as one of iTunes Inspiring Women's podcasts. Mm-hmm. Inspiring Women's Voices, I think was it was. Yeah. And then a really huge one was we were featured as one of the top 10 podcasts for entrepreneurs, mm-hmm. on entrepreneur.com. Mm-hmm. And that was huge. That brought so much attention to the show. Yeah. And what made me think about it was I suddenly received request after request after request. Like I every day flooded with requests from people about whether they would be a good person on the show. And people may remember a while ago, I think on the behind the scenes, I shared a little bit about how to reach out about something like that, or you know, what will help your case.
That's a good approach.
Yeah, what's a great approach. And mm-hmm. and you know, for me, one of the things that was clear was so many people reached out and asked, and they had never even listened to one show. Like this show right in the title says creative living. So I think there's a clue there that you should lead with how whatever it is you do, whether it's selling widgets or marketing warthogs, like whatever it is.
Those warthogs, they need some help.
You know, to tie it, to figure out what's the piece that ties what you do with what I do in the service of the people who listen to the show. Mm-hmm. And so lots of people didn't do that. So we won't be hearing from many of those.
No sparkly intuition there.
There was no sparkly intuition there. And then more recently, like just recently, and what a great way to end off the season, is we were featured as one of the top 5 podcasts for women that you simply must listen to on the Huffington Post.
That's huge.
Yay.
Congratulations, Danny.
Thank you so much. It's very exciting, incredibly rewarding. And you know, in fact, I think what's been the most rewarding about that was to feel the support of the community of listeners. Like there were so many people that said, yay, well deserved. I believe that, you know, and really affirm that. And that touched my heart so deeply because these are the people that listen. Like these are the people, and maybe you guys, I'm talking to you, you know, is that you are the people that are listening and telling your friends and being touched by the work and know what this show is about. And so that kind of support, that kind of celebration, that kind of encouragement from the people who are here and listening and a part of the show, that means the world to me. And I think sometimes too, we get a little nervous. I think many of us get nervous about this. I do too, about people's reaction if you get like, you know, I'm doing a physical movement, which those of you listening can't hear. Like, you know, that whole, like, who do you think you are, Miss Fancy Pants, and don't get too big for your britches kind of thing. And I think that kind of celebration and support counteracts that inner critic.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's totally nice. So thank you to everybody who's been so supportive of the show and also of the accolades that we've received this year. It's so exciting.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, what a year. It's been quite amazing. Those are all happened this year.
I know, right? It's just,
it's wonderful.
It's wonderful. And I think it keeps, you know, when you're doing something for so long, mm-hmm. that kind of infusion of support really helps keep it vibrant, alive, mm-hmm. moving, growing. And I think that's important. I know we can like it to be the same every day all the time.
What? Huh? I so like that.
Yeah. You know, but there's something to be said about just, is always, I think the question is whatever you're doing, is it in support of the aliveness of the thing you are creating? Mm. You know, is it in service of the truth of it, the mission of it, the aliveness?
Feeding it the good stuff.
Yes. You know, like one of the things people are always interested in is like creative practices, creative rituals, creative, you know, and I think that we do all sorts of things to support ourselves. Like I know we both journal, mm-hmm. you know, for example, you have been amazingly committed to morning pages.
Yeah. It's been like, at least at least 4 years now that I've been very, very committed, if not longer.
Yeah, and for those of you who are friends with Shannon on Facebook or you follow her on Instagram, you'll see. Oh, Shannon's I Don't Do Mornings mug is making an appearance today here for the podcast. You'll see.
And that's what that Instagram picture is. That's basically saying I'm sitting down to do my morning pages, as well as saying good morning or good afternoon or good day.
I think that's such a nice thing too, though, because when you share that, you know, somebody else could take that as encouragement to write their own. Like, oh, yeah, remember, I want to write my morning pages today.
Yeah.
Oh, and just in case anybody doesn't know what morning pages are, they're 3 pages of longhand stream of thought consciousness writing. So you just start at the beginning, early in the day, and just anything that's in your head, you dump it onto the page until you reach the end of 3 pages, period.
Yeah, and it's a practice from the artist's way.
Yeah. And Shannon, what do you find the impact of doing the morning pages is? Like, what's made you so committed and what keeps you at it?
It's hard because, like, one of the things is that I noticed if I don't do it, I get really grumpy. So it's kind of like preventative measure. But it helps me sort of clear away all of the like blah, 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 you know, to get to like the actual articulate thought. So for me, it's really good to do them early in the day. I'm not a morning person, so. But I do, yeah, I definitely feel that the impact is that it sort of, I think the ritual of doing them, like to feel like when I start my day, I don't have to think too hard. I don't have to dive right in. I have some time just sort of be there and just sort of like, you know, let my mind wander. And it could be about this, that, or anything. If there's anything truly important, I put it at the top of the page, you know, pay phone bill, whatever, like so that, you know, so that I capture anything that's, I know that probably isn't what you're supposed to do, but for me, it makes things calmer. But, yeah, it's weird because sometimes I want to experiment with not doing them, but I mostly just find I get grumpy and I'm like a little short with people and I'm like, that's not good.
So like, let's all encourage Shannon to stick with the practice of her morning pages. Yeah. But I think that's interesting. I also, maybe we underestimate the value of, for lack of a better word, negative consequences, like for noticing that what goes wrong if we don't do something can still be motivation to do something. You know, we can choose not just to move towards something, but also actively we're choosing to move away from something.
Yeah, and it's like a similar, like in some ways I kind of feel like, oh, well, I should just not be short with people, you know, regardless. But on the other hand, if you think of it like, you know, doing exercise, you know, if you don't do exercise, you're stiffer. You know, or you can't, or you're more out of breath. Well, that's not a bad reason to do exercise. You just be mad at yourself for being stiffer. Like, yeah, that's not very useful.
Yeah.
So it's true. It's a weird, it's a bit of a weird motivation. I don't need to be motivated by negativity, but I don't know if that's, you phrased it better.
Well, I think it's funny because in a way it is the way we phrase it. I don't want to feel grumpy is phrased in a negative way, but really it's a positive thought to not want to be grumpy. Like,
yeah, it makes me happier, you know, or I am more socially acceptable. I've been reading too many, like, you know, historical romances. You know, I'm better in social gatherings if that's, you know, a bit more generic.
Well, I still remember Shannon.
And that's important to me. So,
yeah, you're a very social person, and you're a very amiable person. Like, you're you know, you get along with people really well, and so I can see that you wouldn't want things to be a barrier to that.
Absolutely, it's important to me. So.
And it matters. Like, I will always remember when I had been taking the expressive arts training program, and I was like in creative practice, you know, regularly, and then that program stopped. And a couple of weeks after that, I was like, I'm so grumpy. Why am I so grumpy? And Shannon ever so tenderly said, well, perhaps it is the no longer having a regular creative outlet. I was like, oh, yeah. That would be it.
Yeah.
You know, and so I believe just for myself as a person, as a creative person, for my own health and well-being, and also my integrity, like my integrity with the work.
Yes.
I can't be showing up here telling everybody to get into their creative practice while I just sit around and not do anything. Like, this, you know, that's not,
yeah.
That wouldn't be so great. I wouldn't be able to be in that place of truth and authenticity, you know, or if we're not creating that much, we treat it like we recently filmed an episode of Start with our sister Susie, and we talked about, you know, the struggle of not creating, or the relief of not creating, or like all of the things that happen when we're in that stage where we are not creating.
Mm-hmm. I think part of it is, like, you know, a cycle, like, I think. But part of it, sometimes it's about something more, you know, and then you get that, I don't know, and then it gets uncomfortable, and you're like, no, I want it. Like, right now, for me, I'm very busy, you know, there's lots of social stuff going on, and I'm like, I want to draw, you know, just give me a pen and paper, you know, but, like, sometimes that happens, but, you know, you just get back to it when you can, in the way that you can, and try and shed the judgment, you know, like, that's what I try to do, and it's not easy.
Yeah. And I love, you know, you just talked about it also being a part of a cycle, and that's, mm-hmm. that's I think one of the things we're doing here today by wrapping up our season with the season finale, and also one of the things that more and more I've committed to in the studio is to work with a seasonal rhythm. Mm-hmm. You know, I know for me, if I just try to do the same thing every day forever, I will do it, and I will be exhausted. So I will do it until I sort of have to crap out on it, and then I feel horrible and out of integrity and all sorts, and then come back to it. Where instead, this rhythm is much more beautiful, where, you know, you'll have the podcast, you'll have the behind the scenes, you'll have classes in the studio from September until my birthday, December 7th. And then there'll be a break, and everybody, like, not like us at the studio, excuse me, but also people who are participants can just step away and have a holiday and breathe and relax and not worry, like, not like, give yourself a rest from creating, you know.
Yeah.
Well, like, do goofy stuff, have wonderful experiences, and then come back in the winter and be like, okay, I'm ready to roll, let's do this again, let's have a season, and then we'll take a break for, you know, in between that and the spring and summer season. This is a rhythm that I know works, that is much more, dare I say it, balanced.
Oh, that's my favorite word.
That follows that rhythm of creation, mm-hmm. you know, which gives us an opportunity to celebrate. And then the part I often forget, rest.
Yes.
And then come back with some great new stuff.
Awesome.
So that's where we are. We are celebrating the end of another season, 7 years of the podcast, 7 years of Shannon and I doing this together.
Yes.
Which is awesome. I think this is way more fun doing it together, Shannon.
Absolutely. It's, for me, it's always so exciting because I'm like, who's she going to talk to? What's this week going to be like? Ooh, let's try the bookshelf. How are we going to make that work? I don't know. Let's see what happens. You keep me on my toes.
I love that too, because one of the things you're pointing out is that how creative editing can be, or, you know, that this is another way of coming at something and enjoying the creative process of it.
Mm-hmm. And when you change something or add to something that, you know, because for me, like, if, like, I've been editing the podcast for, I wasn't on right from the beginning, but within the first season, it's like, you know, there's, like, a lot of how to do that hasn't changed, right, who people are has changed. And, you know, we've added sounds and music and stuff like that has changed. But so then when it's a new segment or a new dynamic or a new whatever, it's like, what's this going to be like? And it's a good reminder to shake things up and see what happens. And because there's because you never know what's going to happen when you go down that rabbit hole, like, you know. Music rabbit hole. Oh my gosh, that one's like the music and sounds is like it's engaging on a whole other level, right? Yeah. And like, how do you get them to work together? You know, and it's fun stuff.
It's fun because when we start to do that, this is putting on a show. Like the podcast is a show, and we both sort of want to preserve that integrity of the show as a series. Mm-hmm. You know, and at the same time, make people excited about each season and each episode, including us. Yeah. Like, we want to be excited, like Shannon said, I want to be excited to have those conversations. I want you to be excited about listening to them. I want to be excited about going, oh, how can we put those pieces together? Or, oh, this might be something new that adds a fresh flavor into the mix. And it's fun.
That's good. That's always nice when the energy stays that way, you know, like it makes a difference when things stop being fun. Then it's like, what's going on here? So it's nice that it's still fun. I'm excited about like listening to today.
Awesome. Well, thanks for being here today, Shannon, and thanks for being here for the past like 6+1 seasons or 2 seasons of a long time. And the truth is, thank you for being here forever, because you have always been like such a support, such my go-to person for all this creative work. And I just, we're a team, and it just makes everything more awesome.
Oh, I'm happy to be here, Jamie. It's wonderful to work together.
Yeah. And that just reminds me, sorry, Shannon.
It's been a fun 7 years and more, because we've worked together like in theater, we've worked together at day jobs,
we've done a lot of work together. And I even makes me think of when we had our own eBay vintage clothing company.
Trouvé.
And we loved that too. And so for everybody out there who are interested in working with their loved ones, whether they be friends or family, and people tell you not to do it, we're here to tell you it can work. It can, you know, of course, every family is different, every relationship is different, but if your instinct says, no, this can really work, then, you know, trust your intuition. Shannon and I have been working together probably, honestly, her whole life. Like, since we would cook dinner and she would be my sous chef. So
that was fun.
You know, and so we got it down. You should see us at Thanksgiving dinner.
We have a system.
We have a system. So thanks for another great year, one that has lots to celebrate this season. Like, wow. And we'll be taking a break through August, and we encourage you to do the same, to spend some time, as we said earlier, just, you know, reveling in what it is you want to do with this wild and precious life. Thank you very much, Mary Oliver, for that ongoing touchstone of a quote. And fill your will and get some rest so that when we and you come back in September, everybody's feeling vital and alive and ready to dig in to another wonderful season at the studio and here on the Creative Living with Jamie podcast. Thanks, everybody. Special thank you to Shannon, of course. Thank you to all my guests this season. Thank you to everybody who has shared love, stories, encouragement, and shared the show. Thanks for shining your light, and thanks for shining a light on the work we do here. It means so much. Have a great August, and we will see you in September.
In September.
Bye. We always wave.
Yeah, thank you.